Hi, and welcome to the Assembly Lines podcast. I'm Chris Torrance. In today's episode, I want to take a look at two new products from MFA2 Workshop. So let's get started. Javier, it's good to talk to you.
Great to see you, man.
How you doing?
Nice and dandy.
All right. Hey, I got something to show you.
What?
I got something in the mail the other day from MFA2 in Hong Kong. And you know how you always have those fancy little monitors and you think you're so cool with your night owl. Well, look what I got here.
What?
Yep. It's a little mini Apple IIe.
By itself?
Yep. Here, let me show you. Here's my iPhone right here. So there's the scale.
Oh my God.
Yep. 3.2 inch screen. It all works. Got a little dongle here so you can plug in a keyboard. So unfortunately, the keyboard is like larger than the computer. But yeah, look at that. Are you impressed?
I'm a little bit impressed. Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
I think I can impress you more.
What? No.
Hold on to your horses. Are you ready?
Yep.
Here we go. What is this?
What the heck is that?
You know what this is?
What?
An Apple IIe.
Nah, you're... What?
And this is...
Dude.
Smaller than a... my phone. I cannot even put my phone in there.
Oh my God.
It's so small that I gotta go like this.
That's so tiny.
And run Stutter Replay.
Yep. Awesome.
And you also can control it with a keyboard.
As you can see from the video that Javier and I took, there are two different sizes. There is the 3.2 inch screen size, and then there is the 1.6 inch. They're very similar in features, but there are a couple differences, so let's go over those. First, the 3.2 inch, you can see on the side that it has a port for power and for charging the battery right here. It also has another slot for inserting a micro SD card, and this is where you put all the disk images on. On the other side is a standard USB slot, and this is where you would put a dongle for a keyboard, or you could actually plug in a regular USB keyboard. I went ahead and bought one of these tiny little USB keyboards just for playing around with. And as soon as I turn it on, then it automatically connects to the emulator and we can just start typing away on it. So let's say we want to play Karateka. The performance of the emulator on these two devices seems to be identical with a regular Apple IIe. I haven't noticed any differences in terms of functionality or timing. Everything seems to work, including double high-res and low-res graphics, as well as sound. Okay, and we can just go ahead and play the game just like normal. Obviously, this keyboard is pretty dinky. You could also just plug in a regular USB keyboard if you wanted to. But everything seems smooth and works well, just like on a normal Apple IIe. And we can just go ahead and play whatever games we want. So let's take a look at some other features of the emulator. If I hit Function F1, then I go into the menu, and this is something that MFA2 Workshop has designed so you can easily pick disk images. And so you can see that I have a variety of disk images already on the micro SD card. And if I just pick one of these, let's say for example, we'll pick Death Sword, which is a double high-res game. I can just hit Enter, and then the next time I boot the device, that should come up. So let's turn it off, and we'll turn it back on. Okay, so you can see the game Death Sword came up and it is in double high-res graphics, and so that all seems to be working well. And taking a look at the text at the bottom, I think that MFA2 has done a good job at capturing the way that double high-res works, especially with its color shifting and fringing. Let's go to the Apple II diagnostics disk and we'll take a look at what 80 column text looks like. And I'm gonna actually switch to a bigger keyboard just because this one is so tiny. So I'm gonna pull out the dongle here and I'm gonna put in a dongle for a Logitech keyboard. And we'll go ahead and turn that on. Okay, so there is the 80 column display. I don't know if you can tell from the video, but it's actually crystal clear here on the LCD. And of course, 40 column is also just as readable. And it doesn't seem to have any problems switching between graphics and text. Whenever you enable graphics, it immediately turns on the color burst. And when you go back to text, then it disables or kills the color burst signal. All right, let's just see for fun what's underneath the hood of this thing. So let me turn it off and I'll pop the case off. It actually comes with some screws, but I haven't attached those. So here's the board itself. And let me just unplug it so I can show you what it looks like. So we basically have the LCD on this side and then on the back. So on the back of the board, you can see here's the LCD, and this is just a stock screen that MFA2 has gotten. And then here is his custom board. And so you can see he's got the custom microcontroller here, and this says Wi-Fi on it. So I have a feeling he's actually using a Wi-Fi chip as the actual CPU, but I'm not 100% sure about that. Here's the micro SD card. This is the USB for charging the battery or for powering it. And then this is actually where you plug in a battery, and this just has a standard adapter on it. And then finally, this is the little micro speaker that is included with it. Now, one thing to note is these boards don't come with batteries, and the main reason for that is because it's very difficult to ship batteries, especially internationally. So if I sell these on my store, you'll have to buy your own battery. I won't be including that with the product. But they're easy to find. I actually went on Amazon and I found one that kind of fits this profile right here, and it's also thin enough so you can close the case. And I'll have a link on my website for where you can find batteries that are like that. Another thing to note is that lithium batteries typically come with a slightly larger plug than this one. I'll be including the smaller plug that fits into MFA2's board. But you'll also have to probably desolder the connector that's on the battery that you get and solder on a new one. And this isn't difficult. You just need to pay attention to the plus and minus wires. And actually, when I did it, I got them backwards. But rather than desoldering it again, I just ended up popping the wires out of the plug itself and just flipping them around. So there's no harm if you get them backwards, it just won't turn on. As far as the battery power goes, if you get a small battery, it's not going to last as long, obviously, as the larger one. Here I have a 500 milliamp hour battery, and with this battery, I get about 4 hours of use out of either the 3.2 inch or the 1.6 inch. On this little guy, I have a 250 milliamp hour battery, and this seems to last about an hour and a half. So in hindsight, I probably should have just gotten a bigger battery. I wanted something that would fit kind of on the back of this, sort of like that, but I think I'd actually rather get one that actually fits the entire size of the 1.6 inch emulator, and then you'd get a little bit more life out of it. So the battery itself doesn't last a long time, and under heavy use, you'll probably drain it pretty quickly in just a couple hours, but it's easy to recharge. All right, let's take a look now at the 1.6 inch. So this one works just the same as the 3.2 inch. Super cute. The screen, if anything, is even brighter. Obviously, it's smaller. Now, the one thing about this one is, since it is so much smaller, there wasn't enough room to include two USB ports. So you can see here, all we have is the little micro USB. We don't have the full-size port. So if you're charging the battery, you won't be able to actually use, say, a keyboard wireless adapter at the same time. But as long as the battery's charged, then it'll work. Now, MFA2 actually includes a little USB adapter, which goes from a full-size USB to a micro. And so if I want to use a keyboard with this, I can just plug that into there, and then I just plug my wireless keyboard adapter into that. And obviously, you'd probably want to put this all into a nice, neat package so it wasn't dangling all over the place. But let's go ahead and turn it on, and we'll see how that works. So now I've got Total Replay going, and if we fire up, say, Snoggle. Okay, and you can see that the sound is actually fantastic. It's actually quite loud. Let's go ahead and we'll take a look at the menu on this one, and let me run the Apple IIe Diagnostics. So if I hit Control-Alt-Delete, that's the same as reset or reboot, and then I can just do a PR and number 7 to actually start whatever disk image is mounted on the micro SD card. So let's go ahead and we'll run the same test we ran on the other one. So I'm gonna pick the video pattern tests and we'll do the 80 and 40 column just for fun. Obviously this is gonna be microscopic, but I still wanna see kind of what it looks like. So, all right, so there is the 80 column text. It's a little hard to tell, but the screen is actually quite sharp and the 80 column text is legible. Just like the 3.2 inch, we've got the same components here. So we've got the micro SD here. We have just the micro USB, not a regular USB. Here's where you plug in the battery. And then finally here is the speaker. And you obviously probably want to mount this on the back, but that's kind of left up to the user. Same thing applies for the battery plug. This uses the small size plug, so you will probably have to clip off the one that comes with your battery and solder on the smaller plug instead. As far as disk images, the emulators support DSK, PO, and HDV hard drive images up to 32 megabyte. It doesn't currently support WAS images, but that's something that perhaps could be added in the future. Overall impressions, they're super cool. They're so much fun to play with. They're tiny and they work really well. There are a few quirks, like for example, having to buy your own battery and perhaps solder on the connector for it. The disk reading doesn't seem to be any faster than on a regular Apple IIe. So they can be a little bit slow to load up disk images just like on a regular computer. There are a couple other quirks, like for example, the graphics getting clipped a little bit in the corners on the 1.6 inch emulator. The battery life is a little bit low. It's about 4 hours with a decent sized battery. And obviously, if you get a larger battery, then you could extend this much further. For the 3.2 inch, this isn't a big deal because you can plug it in at the same time, charge the battery while still using it. For the 1.6 inch, the problem is it only has one USB plug. So when it's charging the battery, you can't actually use it because there's nowhere to plug in a keyboard. As far as availability, as you can imagine, these are pretty time consuming to make, especially the case. So MFA2 is planning on offering these as a limited pre-order just to see what the interest level is, and then perhaps if there's enough interest, he'll ramp up production and make more. I'm really curious to see what people make with these. Obviously, the larger one is perfect for creating just a miniature Apple IIe, and the smaller one is just about the same size as an Apple Watch screen. So, But if you do create anything cool, please post some comments as well as pictures, and I'd love to see those. I hope you enjoyed this review of the two new emulators from MFA2 Workshop. I'll have a link in the show notes for where you can find more information about purchasing them. I have a Patreon for my podcast if you'd like to support me further. I'd really appreciate that. And if you haven't subscribed to my YouTube channel, please hit the subscribe button below. Once again, thanks for watching.